Hello, everyone. Commander Hawkins and Captain Foley are back for another episode of Trekyards Technology. Today's topic will be the M5 Multritronic Unit, as seen in the TOS episode, The Ultimate Computer. So let's get underway.
M5 Multritronic Computer was developed in 2260s by Richard Daystrom.
And Dr. Daystrom was the genius responsible for the duotronic computers that were installed on all Starfleet ships of the era.
But this prototype computer, the M5, had the potential to revolutionize the way Starfleet vessels operated, as Daystrom was fond of saying throughout the episode.
Again and again and again. The M5 was originally designed to automate a Constitution-class starship, allowing for a crew of only 20 instead of that of 430 that were normally required for standard missions.
So just like the Vengeance from Miss Darkness, yeah?
Yes, I guess. But you're missing the red shirts. You need red shirts to die, you know?
It's a flawed idea from the start. Yeah, so Dr. Daystrom spent years of his life working on this design. Although units 1 through 4 were not entirely successful, although I think we'll never know what that means exactly, because he wants to bet at least one of those went horribly wrong, and he covered up. I would not put it past Daystrom. Yeah. But unit 5 was considered good enough for field tests, and that's why we saw it in the episode. And this was, of course, the M5.
Now, the M5 was far faster and more powerful than any other computer used in the 2260s, as it used circuit pathways and relays that very closely resembled those of human neural pathways.
But it was fundamentally different to any other computer of the day, as it did not simply process data according to preset programs. It actually think and make intelligent, or logical, as Spock would say, decisions in a crisis situation, both faster and, according to Dr. Daystrom, more accurately than its human counterparts. And I don't know about you, but that sounds ominous already. They should have known and just...
It does indeed, yes. Yeah. To achieve this, Dr. Daystrom imprinted copies of his own memory engrams into the M5's memory banks.
That's not going to go well, is it?
No, not at all. In essence, making it an artificial intelligence. The intention was to replace frailer and more often illogical humans with machine precision, logic, and speed.
Spock was very into this idea.
He loved it, yes. Even though the M5 thought like a man, it could react much faster than any humanoid.
What's interesting about the unit is that while it's so revolutionary, it's very small. It's actually the size of a transporter console station and consisted of a circular and rectangular display screens, top-mounted keyboard, and power input port.
The circular display unit showed the computer processing functions. Though these were a series of colors and shapes which were not immediately understandable, the computer used the form... Yeah. Trippy. The computer used a form of high-speed visual language.
When in operation, it produced a high-pitched humming sound and a series of lights flickering across a rectangular display control panel, which is obviously not too dissimilar from the other computer monitors we see in the TOS era on the bridge, but I guess more advanced.
Yeah. Interface with the computer was through both vocal and keyboard commands. The machine also had the ability to generate a force field around itself to protect itself from direct attack.
Force field. Why would Daystrom put a force field generator inside a computer? That seems...
I'm not necessarily convinced he did. How do we know that there's not force field generators in engineering to isolate any damage to the reactor, anything like that? Automatic force field. It's like when you get a hull breach, you have the force field to, you know.
Yeah, so we're after
not engineering.
Obviously, we're after NXO1 time, we have to have bulkheads. So, yeah. Although, if you think about it, I mean, I know this is obviously the prototype sort of thing, but I can imagine Daystrom really pushing ahead of the curve. I mean, this is the computer system that would be the life force of the entire ship. You know, I know it's going to also be deep inside the vessel, but you can imagine if an enemy gets a good shot in, destroys the computer system, or even damages it, your ship is almost totally screwed. So I could almost see them putting some sort of shielding on it, but maybe Daystrom went one step forward and put a full-on shield generator because he's a bit unhinged.
Paranoid? Yeah.
Yeah.
I think...
But just like we saw in the episode, the M5 was installed aboard the Enterprise in 2268, and it was located in main engineering, and was tapped directly into the ship's main power grid, which meant it could selectively deactivate life support and unnecessary power usage as it saw fit. And that was some ominous bits of this episode when, you know, power going down on deck 2 and everything goes dark. It's like, this is a bad sign, guys. Have you not watched Star Trek before? You haven't, but...
It successfully completed navigational and research tests before changing course and deliberately attacking and destroying the robotic freighter Woden, and then refused to surrender control of the Enterprise back to its human counterparts.
Yeah, also more bad signs, guys. Come on. But during the attempts to deactivate the unit, the M5 actually was pretty ingenious. It rerouted command functions through new data lines and kept sending false signals through the original ones. So it meant that the crew was trying to reroute what they thought would give them control of the ship, but complete waste of time. Pretty clever.
Finally, after attempting to remove the M5 from the ship's power grid, the M5 killed a crewman.
Was it a red shirt?
Of course it was a red shirt.
Good. Wait, no. Good.
As it tapped directly into the warp core, essentially giving itself an unlimited and inexhaustible supply of power.
Jesus. And then the M5 then attacked four other Constitution-class ships, the Excalibur, Lexington, Potemkin, and the Hood. And they were all engaged in, you know, scheduled war games. But M5 went crazy. and the result of this was the loss of hundreds of lives and the complete destruction of the Excalibur and severe damage to all the other ships. And all because of the M5's sense of self-preservation. And we've seen a lot of television movies. What is it with self-preservation that leads to robots just leading on to rampages and killing and slaughter and destruction? It's just...
Well, it's like humans with war. Greed creates war, and then, you know, you want to invade the other people, and then they want to have self-preservation. They have self-preservation, so they fight back. They create war. Self-preservation is the downfall.
Don't build robots. Androids are fine. No robots. Except Law. He's not fine. But Data, some androids.
Just build Data, is what we're saying.
No, don't do that.
It seemed that Dr. Daystrom had been suffering from severe stress and overwork and was indeed mentally unstable. And this resulted in his flaws being passed along in his own memory engrams to his creation.
I could have called that.
Fortunately, though, Dr. Daystrom also passed along his sense of right and wrong and the ability to feel guilt and regret. When Kirk confronted the computer with the reality of its actions and the extreme loss of life, the machine decided that it had offended against the laws of nature, and it then deactivated itself.
But
go Kirk. Kirk logic.
No Kung Fu, is no Kirk Fu, it's Kirk logic.
Yes.
But what's interesting about the character of Daystrom, he's actually very, very important to that era, you know, of Star Trek and development of Federation technology. He invented, like we said earlier, he invented duotronic circuitry, which powered the Constitution class and the refit and beyond. We'll talk about that in a minute. The next major innovation for computer technology was the isolinear chips, which we saw as standard on the Enterprise D in 2363. But we saw a more primitive design called the Enterprise B in 2293. So I guess it got phased out.
Yeah, Daystrom was 26 when the Enterprise launched with his duotronic relays already installed. He says in the episode that he was a boy wonder, implying that he came up with the idea quite a few years before the Constitution class was created, perhaps even before the four-year war. This does mean that it is likely that everything in the Axanar period, Cage, and original series timelines all used his computer systems, so, and potentially beyond.
I mean, that's a lot of history that just completely runs in his circuitry. I mean, and you know how things develop now. That's like, wow, it's incredible. Although, I mean, how far do you think it went? Like, so we saw the Enterprise B isolinear chips, and while maybe not the same design, they're much chunkier. Do you think the refit and the A and these things had duotronic, maybe just version 2.0?
Yeah, I think so. I think the definitely the A still had the duotronics, but I think since the Enterprise is the flagship, the Enterprise B would have been state-of-the-art, top of the line at the time, so it probably incorporated the new isolinear design, probably in conjunction with the duotronics. Who knows, really? But it's an interesting point that, yeah, I think at least up until Enterprise B had the duotronics.
Well, it makes sense, though. I mean, if you think about, you know, obviously we said Enterprise D was standard, but it wasn't old technology. So perhaps the B, like I said, was the prototype, the field test. We know that the Intrepid class Voyager was the sort of the main field test of the binaural gel packs. So yeah, makes sense that I guess the B would be the field test. I mean, they are chunkier. They are, I guess, less advanced. But yeah, probably quite late to that period. So I mean, that's a long time Federation history that's running on this stuff. So pretty important guy.
Way to go, Dr. Daystrom. Good job.
Apart from the M5.
Anyway, time to move on to behind the scenes. So the voice of the M5 unit was supplied by Mr. James Doohan, or as some of you may know him, Scotty. It's worth pointing out as well that even though the rest of the Starfleet computers had female voices, the M5 had a distinctly male voice.
Similar to the one they used in the Mirror Universe, which also had a male voice to be different. So, second
time. Interesting, yeah.
What's awesome is the M5 actually appeared again, sort of on screen, but in a screen of your video game console, in the Star Trek game Star Trek Shattered Universe, which is a PS2 Xbox original game back in 2004. Yeah. And it's awesome because it's the Excelsior Mirror Universe one with Sulu. It's a really fun game, actually, and a great story. And in this Mirror Universe, the M5 is actually taking control of, ironically, the Mirror Universe equivalent of the Constitution class, Excalibur, Hood, Lexington, and Potemkin, and all their small fighters. And you have to, you know, take them on an awesome dogfight, and by destroying the four Constitution classes, all the shuttles go down. So it's kind of fun. You don't get to see it again. You get to fight it, and it's just, yeah.
It is a fun game. It's actually, I really enjoyed it. I did beat it. It took me a lot of save points because it's a hard game, but it is fun to play through for sure.
Yeah, I didn't get through it all because it's quite a little bit tedious sometimes, but it's very creative, I think. And the Mirror Universe, I mean, come on. And yeah, it's just a good game. Do check it out.
I had to finish it just for the storyline.
Yeah.
So anyway, in the non-canon novel Immortal Coil, the failed M5 has become part of Dr. Vaslovsky's, aka Flint the Immortal's, collection on Valhalla. And it even helped defend the station in 2374 during the Dominion War. Now, Flint, for those of you that might not know, was from the TOS episode Requiem for Methuselah. And he is an immortal, having lived on Earth for more than 6,000 years, and being such historic figures as Moses, Alexander the Great, King Solomon, Da Vinci, and many more, before actually leaving Earth, and then later being discovered by Kirk and crew.
So saying the M5 unit from TOS helped fight the Dominion? It was still around?
Yeah, well, he was a collector of things. And since he was a genius, obviously, he probably repaired it, and it was in charge of defenses and probably automation for his palace. So
they just loaded it out when they needed it, sort of thing. Wow.
Yeah.
It redeemed itself, sort of thing. And then it blew up 10 galaxy classes that came by.
I was killing the Dominion. We're fine.
Okay. And one last bit of trivia. We do actually see parts of the M5 again. Well, the props anyway, in the TOS episode Assignment Earth as Gary Seven's computer.
Yeah, and I think that was just a simple reuse of the, you know, typical TOS reuse.
It's a cool prop, and it makes his office feel way more advanced, which is awesome.
So now it's time to move on to the discussion part of the show. Well, The Ultimate Computer is indeed one of my favorite episodes, as was Assignment Earth, ironically enough. So this is indeed one of my favorite pieces of tech from Trek. That sounds like a show in itself. We should change the name of technology to Tech in Trek.
Continue, Stuart.
Anyway, I actually really like the way the unit looks, except, of course, for the circular display, which is clearly just a projector shining lights onto the screen from behind. But the main rectangular control scheme is really cool looking, and I think it's one of my favorite computer displays from any Trek, actually. But yeah, I could really do without the circular part. I think the screen with scrolling numbers or technical readouts, kind of like HAL from 2001, would be much better. I also feel like by that time period, artificial intelligence would actually be a reality. So the whole concept of a computer that could make decisions would likely already be in existence. But I really feel that machines can never really replace man. I'm kind of like McCoy in that aspect. But we'll always kind of need to be there to keep the human element, you know, to keep things from going wrong. So
getting philosophical here on Trekyards, aren't we, Stuart?
We do that sometimes. We do that.
Yeah, anyway, I like the episode too. I think it's a good take on the classic of AI machine intelligence development story. I love that we get to meet the man, like I said before, who designed the inner workings of the Enterprise and all computers at that time. It's sad to see someone who's always reaching for that next big achievement, trying to outshine his own, well, revolutionary design. Hard thing for a scientist, but it sure adds a lot to the episode. I also think it's a good episode in the sense that you get to see the first steps towards more advanced computers. I mean, Star Trek obviously developed a lot all the way into bioneural gel packs, which obviously have that organic twist as well, maybe not the same route. So Daystrom it wasn't about advanced technology in terms of tech, it was about pushing towards a bit more of an organic side. He was just on the wrong track a bit. And certainly technology like this would have been useful, especially for star bases. I don't think ships, it's the best option. Especially in this episode, we see if it goes wrong, it goes wrong bad. But still, interesting idea. Yeah. What did you think of the M5 concept? And especially, you know, how do you think it could be used in the TOS universe anyway?
I think it was a great concept. But for use aboard a Constitution class ship, I don't think really is a great use of it. I mean, they're out exploring and they're going to run into the unknown and the unpredictable. And I don't think computers should be really dealing with that kind of thing.
And you really shouldn't be blowing up every ship you see. It's not a good first impressions, is it?
That's not good. But I like your thought about star bases. The M5 for running an entire star base is brilliant because there's less chance of that unknown interaction out there. You know, you're controlling traffic, docking, undocking, cargo, all the, you know, onboard systems like life support. So that or ground-based systems.
But then, if you put it in a starbase, you put those two guys, you know, that work with the control panels in that big, in that awesome open starbase shot, they put them out of a job, and they need their job, you know? Their kids need that money. Well, not money, but they need those replicator rations. They're not replicators yet. I don't know.
No, they can just go hang out and, you know, have a good life. I don't know.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting idea, like you say. I think to go off that idea, it'd be great for planetary infrastructure. You know, put the M5, maybe not the homicidal version, but the refined version on a planet. Let it control, you know, some of the basic processes, you know, management of power, electricity, some resources, and just, I mean, you could really help a colony, you know, establish and really help automate it and just make it more sustainable. Yeah, having just in the background doing simple tasks. But I do think, like I sort of mentioned throughout the episode, it's dangerous to have a human imprint on it or anything that human-machine combination, because it does seem to go wrong a lot of the time. Even if it's jumping technology, I think the positive negatives outweigh the positives. So that's just my idea.
Yeah. Okay, so now it's time of the show where we move on to ways we would use this tech today. So I would basically have this thing do all the tasks I didn't want to do. You know, while I got fat on the couch eating donuts. So I have a controller robot that does like laundry, cuts my grass, maybe even write these Trekyards scripts, you know, for me. So a little bit better, maybe.
No creative flair, you know. It's too homicidal scripts. I mean, it'll be like kill humans, kill their humans. Terrible for scripts.
That's the early drafts that I write. No, I'm just kidding. It would save me a lot of time and allow me to just kind of relax. But I would still, of course, do all the fun things, you know. I don't know. Really, what are some of your ideas, Samuel?
Well, it's a supercomputer, right? So I would take over the world.
Of course you would.
But I guess Skynet is born? Wait, wrong franchise. Okay, I wouldn't do that. I'm kidding. No world conquering for me. No.
You're like a Bond villain.
Yeah. I mean, a supercomputer is awesome. And not just a supercomputer, but one that can react and extrapolate. I don't think I'd necessarily use it to its full potential, because what would I do? You know, run my bank accounts and my car? I mean, it's fine. But it's an advanced piece of tech, and I think I could use raw processing power towards my editing and make Trekyards faster. You know, I have on a separate monitor and say, you know, M5, do this task. You know, green screening. I mean, it's a hard thing to do, and say, M5, make all the green disappear, and it does it perfectly in 1 second, and it's just, magic. I mean, that'd be great. Really, really great. Maybe even, I don't know if you've seen the TV show Eureka, but they got a smart house in that, and that'd be awesome, as long as it's not the homicidal version, the version 3, you know, the nice human-friendly version, maybe the woman's voice, like in the show, and have, you know, smart house, you know, controls all the things and can make your toast for you while you get up out of bed. That'd be cool. I enjoy that, as long as it doesn't try and kill me, obviously. Honestly, I think this sort of thing is most likely to try and go more powerful, take over the world. So I would delete the operating system, install Windows, and then just use it, you know, as an editing computer, and then have the M5 light show my wall as a bit of art. It'd be great. So that's what I'd use it for.
Yeah, the circular display that I complained about would make an awesome just kind of light show.
Yeah, perfect.
All right, guys. Well, that's another technology finished. Hope you enjoyed this look at the M5 Multitronic unit from TOS. Please check out all our past technologies and all Trekyards for that matter over on the website trekyards.com. Excuse me. Also follow us on Facebook and Twitter. If you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe. And we will see you guys next time. This is Captain Foley and Commander Cockings signing off. Until next Saturday. Bye, guys.
Bye.